Now let's join together in prayer, okay? Father, you have exalted your Son, Jesus, to the highest place, even as he humbled himself by becoming a servant and by obeying you even to the point of death, death on a cross. And Father, we thank you that you have exalted him to the highest place so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. And Father, that's our desire this morning as we worship you in this place, that we would exalt the name of Jesus Christ to the very place in which you've put it. And we pray this in his name. Amen. Our middle school students are currently going through a series on Christian jargon. Now, that's a great series. Because being in a church, especially for our middle school 6th, 7th, and 8th graders, it's so easy to find Christian language swirling around us without us really giving a second thought as to the significance and the meaning of those terms. And I had the honor of being with our middle school students this last Friday, and the word that I chose to share with them, this Christian jargon that we toss around so easily, the word I chose was fellowship. Because we think, you know, come to this event because there's fun and there's obviously food, and please come for the fellowship. Or we want to invite our friends to a fellowship meeting. And more often than not, we could use the term fellowship without really giving a second thought to it. And I thought, how do I get myself in the door talking about fellowship? So naturally, I thought about friendship. And I started our time together by simply giving them a phrase: a good friend is someone who... And our middle schoolers came up with brilliant responses. A friend is someone who is not judgmental. A good friend is someone who is loyal. A good friend is someone who is trustworthy and forgiving and transparent. And they came up with just a great description of what good friends are all about. And then we talked about how fellowship is really a gathering of good friends that center their friendship upon Jesus Christ and the gospel. There are like 40 plus students in our gathering Friday evening. And I was so overwhelmed with their enthusiasm to learn and to be a part of the fellowship together. And after our time together, four students came up to me and I could see that they had a question. And these four students came up to me and one of them was the spokesperson and then they said, "We have a situation." And they described a situation with a friendship that had somehow fallen on the wayside. And they wanted to know what to do. This coming week, we're going to be gathering together with family and friends. And it's possible that you have a family member who's not yet a follower of Jesus Christ, and you've been praying for them and hoping that they would come to a position where you were standing, where they would exalt Jesus' name above every name. And yet, at best, your family member is kind of apathetic, but at worst, your family member can get a little defensive and even testy and hostile toward conversations of faith. It's been a hard decision, but you sense that it's time to move on. There's a new opportunity, and as you contemplate this opportunity, and as you feel excitement and anticipation, one of the struggles within your own heart is those that you'll leave behind. And sharing with them about the decision that you have made. Uncomfortable situations. A friendship where you begin a conversation with, "Can we talk?" A family gathering during what is to be a festive celebration and a time of recollection of memories and a building of new memories feels a little bit awkward as you think about the faith and as you have a burden to share the gospel with your family member that's not yet a follower of Christ. the mixture of feelings that you have as you look forward to a great opportunity that takes you elsewhere, but the thought of leaving people behind, it's a tough conversation. Uncomfortable situations. And for someone who is at home with always being on the road, standing before crowds of people, interacting with individuals that he has never met before in his life, defending the truth, persuading others to come to faith in Jesus Christ, encountering just about every near-death experience for the sake of the gospel, Paul finds himself smack in the middle of an uncomfortable situation. You see, backed up against a wall, with the integrity of his character and the gospel on the line, Paul resorts to a kind of dialogue that he feels really, really uncomfortable with. It's a queasy type of conversation. It makes him feel like, I don't want to do this. Because he must explain why his ministry is better than others. He must actually venture into an uncomfortably difficult conversation where he says that he's actually a better leader, spiritually speaking, than these other leaders that are exerting a destructive, harmful, detrimental influence on men and women and students that he loves deeply. Paul's going to have to talk about how his leadership results in more praise to Jesus than his critics. And it's a defense that is necessarily, and for Paul, uncomfortably autobiographical. You see, through Paul's own reluctant admission, we pick up the qualities of a better leader, a better servant, and a better ministry. Jesus gains greater glory through a tenacious spirit and a tender heart. We serve Jesus better when we never quit and always care. We have a better church and a better community of leaders, and we become better followers of Christ when we never quit and when we always care. Because traits like tenacity and tenderness merit our conversation, even if it comes across to others a little bit too much about ourselves. Paul finds himself in an uncomfortable situation where he talks more about his experiences and his emotions in this letter than in any other letter that he has penned. But with the emerging influence of false apostles assaulting his integrity and masquerading as servants of righteousness, Paul must defend himself. And as we saw at the early part of this chapter, Paul has the truth of Christ in himself, both in what he says and how he acts. And that distinguishes the apostle from this group of dangerous, deceptive apostles that are actually promoting a different Jesus and advocating a different spirit and really marshaling a different gospel. And we encounter similar challenges today. Spiritual leaders rise up. They claim a word from God. They dominate and rule over others. In fact, even this past week, I received a note from a student whose roommate goes to a church that is questionable. And the student fired out an email and said, Have you heard of this church before? It sounds a little bit cultic. And sure enough, if you were to follow the trail of this ministry, you find a place that is very authoritarian and domineering, where people have apostolic prophetic claims and they really exercise a form of spiritual abuse and they malign the hearts and the souls of people. And so what's at stake is the sincerity and the purity of our devotion to Jesus. So like Paul, our conversations may occasionally revolve a little bit more around ourselves and what God is doing in our life, even in a way that feels somewhat uncomfortable. But as we do, It's really not speaking about ourselves. But as we talk about the texture of our life and how it differs from others, it really ultimately points to the one whose name that we are exalting this morning. And so the title for this morning's talk is simply Boasting Humbly, because that is what Paul does. He does something he feels very uncomfortable with. He boasts, but as he boasts, he takes us down a very different path, because it's boasting with profound humility. And so if you have a Bible, I'd like you to go ahead and turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 11. And we're going to hear how Paul focuses not on his victories, but on his defeats. It's an unexpected twist when it comes to putting out a word about ourselves on the street. When you create a resume, we try to highlight the strengths and the accomplishments, the things that commend us to someone else. And yet when Paul puts together a resume, it's the type of resume that turns our world upside down, because rather than highlighting his strengths, he likes to underscore his adversities and his struggles. And so in verses 16 to 21, we're looking at the second half of 2 Corinthians chapter 11, we're going to see how Paul talks big, that is, how we could boast in what we say. And this is that uncomfortable situation that we find ourselves slipping into when we necessarily are called to defend the integrity of the gospel and even our own integrity as followers of Christ. And then we're going to see in verses 22 to 33 that Paul not only talks big, but he challenges us to be like himself, to live bigger. That is humility in how we serve. And in a section of his letter, starting with chapter 10, where we hear language of comparisons and boasting and bragging, along with Paul's resistance of this condescending approach, Paul actually pleads for a little more patience and tolerance. Take a look at verse 16. Continuing the thought as he asked the Corinthians for a little bit more time on the clock. I repeat, let no one take me for a fool. But if you do, then tolerate me just as you would a fool, so that I may do a little boasting. In this self-confident boasting, I'm not talking as the Lord would, but as a fool. Since many are boasting in the way the world does, I too will boast. You see, Paul starts with a disclaimer. We ask ourselves the words of Oswald Chambers, what would Jesus do? And Paul says, I tell you this, what Jesus would not do is what I'm about to do. Jesus, the selfless, serving Son of God, who humbled himself by becoming human and obeying the Father even to the point of death, his life and ministry were marked not with boasting, but with humility, condescension, sacrifice. And what Paul ventures to do is something that he admits that Jesus himself would not do. It comes across as a little bit crazy and odd. It doesn't really make sense. But the concession is that Paul knows how enamored and impressed the Corinthians had become with these, earlier in the chapter, he called them over the top, beyond the measure, advanced placed, super duper apostles. And he understands that the Corinthians are enamored and fascinated and struck with the power and the oratorical skill of these apostles. Because they look at Paul and they say, Paul, you talk big, but you live little. And Paul says, just wait for a little bit here. And Paul understands what strikes the heart of the Corinthians. So Paul, as it were, stoops to the level of his adversaries. He goes to the level of his opponents and argues on their terms. He fights with their strategy, even though he resists it initially. Because he understands how he must prove that his ministry is actually, and he really doesn't like this, but he has to prove how his ministry is better than the ministry of these super apostles, because they're really just a bunch of fakes. They're masquerading like Satan as servants of righteousness. Our culture loves to talk about our need for tolerance. In fact, in our postmodern anything-goes culture that usually translates into tolerating any and every idea except biblical Christian faith. And so whenever we talk about Jesus being the only way or the reality of heaven and hell or the authority of the Bible, and when we begin to unfold the biblical truth of what we believe, the world shouts back to us and says, we're tolerant for every idea and every religious expression and every political stripe except what you're going to represent from the Christian faith. And it's this type of climate and culture in which we live that we actually harness the posture of Paul that speaks to our non-believing family and friends and says, hey, just hang in there with me a little bit more. Can you show me just a little bit more patience? Can you extend a little bit more grace? Can you open up your ears a little bit longer so that I could explain the difference between what I believe and what everyone else believes? And you may find yourself in conversations with a friend who has this pushback to your thoughts about the Christian faith and what you believe about Jesus, and you may come back to them and say, can you just hang in there with me a little bit more? In this letter that Paul writes, talking much about himself and defending not only his own personal integrity, but the truth of the gospel, we see how he is just dripping with sarcasm and irony. It's all over the pages of this letter. And that's what we find in verse 19. Paul already knows that his readers are tolerant and they could extend a little bit more tolerance to him because they've given a truckload of confidence to these pseudo-apostles in the church. You gladly, verse 19, put up with fools since you're so wise. Again, tongue-in-cheek, dripping with sarcasm, just laughing out loud as he writes these words. You guys have great wisdom because you put up with these fools. The tolerance of these leaders has had a destructive and detrimental influence on their faith, their relationship with Jesus. Verse 20, in fact, you even put up with anyone who enslaves you or exploits you or takes advantage of you or puts on airs or slaps you on the face. You see, despite their super spiritual appearances and authoritative posture, these leaders are actually not looking out for the well-being of those that they are over, but they're actually destroying them. They're exploiting them. They're taking advantage of them. They're consuming them. They're picking their pockets. They're a harmful influence. They have the appearance of godliness, but they're really ripping the people off. They're hurting them. And more often than not in our generation, the problem is not with someone who's obviously heretical, but it's with people that are subtly abusive, where they use guilt and manipulation and the titles of a spiritual leader and an apostle and a prophet that actually rip people off, if not physically, financially. Where there's actually, in some religious sectors, physical abuse to beat people into submission. And so it shouldn't shock us because that's exactly what we see in the pages of Paul's letter to the church at Corinth. And full of sarcasm, Paul goes on to confess that he's ashamed for not being the same kind of strong leaders as these super apostles. Take a look at 21. He says, to my shame, I admit that we were too weak for that. We were spiritual wimps. We didn't have that authority to pick your pockets, to abuse you, to make you feel guilty, to destroy your faith. Whatever anyone else dares to boast about, Paul says, I'm speaking as a fool. I also dare to boast about. You may know someone, it's very possible, who is in a Corinthian-like community where they are in a place that talks language that we talk, but has leaders that are manipulating and that are dominating and that are authoritarian. And rather than leading by example, they exploit and they bully the faithful, including perhaps your friend or family member. They bully them into submission. And enslaved and beaten down, you sense a need to step in and do something. And at the very minimum, you want to share your concerns. You want to come up to them and you want to communicate with them and maybe even begin a conversation that says, you know, I could be seeing things in a little bit incomplete manner, but what I sense, and again, this is what I sense, there's some dangers that I see. And your friend might say, what are you talking about? And then you might walk into that conversation and say something like, the dangers that I see is that it seems like the leaders or the people have people in their grips. And there's a forcefulness and a pressure and even, and I hate to say this, and I feel uncomfortable saying this, but even a bullying of people into obedience. It's an uncomfortable situation. It's a difficult conversation. But what's at stake is the simplicity and the purity of our devotion to Christ. When Kay Brown got on the number 3 train in New York City earlier this week, she wasn't expecting to be a hero. But all it took was 1 minute and 1 pair of shoes. The 26-year-old nonprofit worker was on the train in Manhattan after work when a homeless woman, apparently homeless woman, got onto her subway car wearing a light jacket, a thin shirt, and no shoes. And Kay Brown says that you see the subway each day and you see how gross it is, and this woman walked on, and it's in the middle of November, and most of the nation, apart from our state, is cold right now. And in the middle of November, I noticed immediately that she was barefoot. And so Brown asked the woman very gently and kindly what her shoe size was. And they happened to have the exact same size for shoes. And so the woman offered, Kay Brown says, let me give you my shoes. And as Kay Brown began to take off her boots, this woman that she was talking to said, no, please, you don't need to do this. And Kay Brown said, this is what I want to do. And she explains. She says, something in me, it's just being a human, you know. I had to reach out to her. She was so gracious and so nice. And then she started crying and bent down as she was putting her shoes on. There was nothing, Kay Brown says, that I've ever felt that good to do for somebody. You see, with nothing on her feet but her mismatched socks, not sure why she dressed this way, but that's all she had. Another passenger on the plane was so struck by her compassion and generosity, this other passenger asked if she could take a selfie with her. Another passenger must have went shopping, or I don't know if he took off his own socks, but he gave her another pair of socks so that she could put on a second pair of socks for her 6-block walk home after getting off the subway. What this woman learned on that day in this subway car is she says, what is 6 blocks when somebody has been living God knows how long without any shoes on her feet? It really makes you think, wow, I need to put myself in their position. You see, as followers of Christ, compassion moves us to serve others. even if that means taking off our own shoes for someone else. For Paul, no price is too high. No sacrifice is too much when it comes to serving others, because we never quit when we truly care. So while our words enable us to talk big, Paul shows how our actions empower us to live bigger. More than just what we say, we learn from Paul how we can practice humility in how we serve. And so when you take a look at verses 22 and following, as a true apostle, Paul begins to compare and contrast himself with these pseudo-apostles. And he begins by getting into their common heritage in verse 22. Are they Hebrews, that he's these false apostles that are masquerading as servants of righteousness? Paul says, so am I. Are they Israelites, the people of God, people connected with the people that God had chosen and blessed through Abraham, the patriarch? Paul says, so am I. And then Paul gets even more specific. He says, are they descendants of Abraham? That is, do they share the heritage that we have, that God made when he promised Abraham that he would bless him and his family, and through their family, all the families on the planet, every nation on the planet? And Paul says, check, that's me as well. And at first glance, they appear to be equals, at least ethnically and historically. They share the same background as Hebrews, as the people of Israel, and as physical descendants of Abraham. So on the surface, in a similar way, we might share a common heritage with people that talk the same language we do, that go to churches just like ours, attending a church, being part of a religious gathering, familiarity with the stories of the Bible and knowing some strands of the teaching of Jesus, and talking about the need to pray. Religious stuff that they could talk about, but we could also talk about. But a shared history and a common heritage doesn't necessarily put us on the same page. And as Paul reluctantly brags about himself, he pops a fourth question that takes us down an unexpected road. And the road is not filled with stars and with accomplishments and great success, but it's filled with scars and agony and failures from a human perspective. And based on the enduring quality of Paul's faithfulness, he declares that he comes out ahead. Take a look beginning at verse 23. And it's as if Paul says, let's fasten our seatbelts, because what he's about to detail for us will just blow us completely out of the water. Are they servants of Christ? We've got the common heritage, Hebrews, Israel, Abraham. Check, check, check. The fourth question is the huge dividing line between him and them. Are they servants of Christ? Feeling uncomfortable in this situation, parenthetically, he says, I'm out of my mind to talk like this. I am more. Wow. Are they servants? I'm better. Do they serve God? My ministry is even better than theirs. Do they bring glory to Jesus? I bring much greater glory to Jesus. I have worked much harder, been in prison more frequently, been flogged more severely, been exposed to death again and again. 5 times I received from the Jews the 40 lashes minus one. 3 times I was beaten with rods. 1 I was pelted with stones. 3 I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea. 26, I have been constantly on the move, a spiritual fugitive on the run. I have been in danger from rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my fellow Jews, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the country, in danger at sea, and in danger from false believers. Rhetorically, Paul is saying, essentially, there's not a single danger I have never faced. I have labored and toiled and have often gone without sleep. I've known hunger and thirst and have often gone without food. I have been cold and naked. You see, in a letter that reveals more about himself and his heart than any other place, Paul includes a list of hardships three times in the second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 4, chapter 6, and here in chapter 11. And this is the most detailed, the most graphic, the most developed profile of what he has endured as a servant of the gospel. You see, while Paul shares a common history and tradition with his rival leaders, he rises above as he showcases an uncommon humility. In a word, Paul is tenacious. Because of his affection for Jesus and his allegiance to the gospel, he never quits. He never waves the right flag. He never throws in the towel. He never taps out. He sticks with Jesus through thick and thin. And the apostle's resume of unwavering faithfulness has a been there, done that, seen it all attitude. And it's not to promote himself, but it's to elevate Jesus, to say that there is no danger, there is no adversity, there is no deprivation that is too great for Jesus. You see, his tenacity underscores the worth of our Savior. He has truly seen it all, and he has remained laser focused on Jesus. As we scroll through this turbulent and rough and tough chronicle of the experiences that Paul endured, we realize that brothers and sisters in different places around the world are facing things not much different from what Paul faced. That they are being flogged, and that they are being imprisoned, and that they are being pelted with stones, and that they experience deprivation, even loss of employment and loss of food and loss of opportunities and loss of relationships because of their loyalty to the gospel. And their faithful and steadfast loyalty to the gospel humbles us. And as we lift them up in our prayers, we also lift them up as examples to us. When we find ourselves wobbling in our own faith, you see, we may not be beaten with rods, and we may not be thrown in prison, and we may not spend a day and a night at sea. But there are seasons when we feel exhausted, when we feel drained, when we are tempted to wave the white flag and to give it up, when we begin to think that, is it really worthwhile to stick with Jesus? And there's a part of our heart that experiences a temptation to maintain the shell of a Christian faith, but our heart has become cold. And the example of Paul and the example of the faithful in places around the world motivate us to remain tough, to not quit, to stay with Jesus. You see, as a better servant, Paul cheers us on to love Jesus and to serve others, regardless of what that entails, or even where that takes us. On top of all that he's faced from the outside, Paul also discloses what he feels on the inside. Take a look at 28 and 29. Besides everything else, on top of all that I've just talked about, I face daily the pressure of my concern, literally the anxiety that occupies him. I face daily the pressure of my anxiety and concern for all the churches. Who is weak and I don't feel weak? Who is led into sin and I do not inwardly burn? You see, for the most part, the relentless external opposition that Paul has endured comes from those outside the church. In proclaiming the truth of Jesus, Paul has been battered and bruised in every imaginable way. Been there, done that, seen it all, every conceivable near-death experience for the sake of the gospel. But coupled with this never-ceasing persecution from outsiders is this always-present pressure that he feels for those within. The everyday burden of concern for all the churches. And as Paul is compelled to talk in a way that's uncomfortable for him, he argues that his ministry is superior to these super pseudo-apostles because his heart and mind are always on the churches. He's preoccupied with compassion and a care for those who have already begun to follow Jesus. And that naturally includes the Corinthians. It's as if he wants the Corinthians to understand that part of the love and the commitment he has for all the churches is the love and the anxiety and the concern that he feels within his own heart. Because he fears that they are being lured away from the simplicity and the purity of their devotion to Christ. He worries about their spiritual condition. So in verse 29, we hear that he sympathizes with the weak. And when disciples fall into sin, his heart burns with an angry grief. I like the way the Message paraphrases this. When someone gets to the end of his rope, I feel desperation in my bones. When you see someone, a fellow believer in Jesus Christ, come to the end of the rope, it's feeling desperation in our bones, a sadness in our heart, a sympathy that goes out to them, a desire that they would hang on to their faith. And then Peterson goes on to paraphrase, when someone is duped into sin, an angry fire burns in my gut. The English Standard Version says, we become indignant. How about us? How about you? Would those who know us well say that we're compassionate? Do people sense the care that we have for them, especially when they're desperate? When they find themselves at the end of their rope, can they look over their shoulder and see you reaching out for them? Can they hear around them the prayers that are being lifted up in their behalf? Do we find our hearts aching with others when they feel weak? When we see someone else flirting with danger, do we try to intervene? Do we step in, not just barge in, but do we step in with grace and with truth, with love and with integrity? Does sadness and passion burn within us when a fellow disciple is yielding to sin or walks away from the faith? You see, Paul models a better ministry because he truly cares for all the churches. And then Paul ends the chapter with a minor episode, something that we would put as a footnote to our resume of accomplishments, maybe not even include there. But it's a minor episode from his earliest days as a disciple of Jesus. And what might come across as a wee bit embarrassing, Paul wants to, as it were, end with a bang to say, this is what I want to put in a prized place, on the shelf, showcasing for all to see. This is an example of weakness that magnifies the worth and the glory of God. He says in verse 30, if I must boast, I will boast of the things that show my weakness. The God and Father of our Lord Jesus, who is to be praised forever, knows that I'm not lying. And we talk about honest to God and how that is the profile of Paul in this letter. So Paul once again reiterates the integrity of his words and actions. If there's one thing that burns within the heart of an apostle and the heart of a servant of God, it's when our integrity is called into question. And Paul is no exception. He says, in Damascus, the governor under King Aretas had the city of the Damascenes guarded in order to arrest me. There was a conspiracy to kill Paul because he had changed sides, no longer a persecutor of the church. He was a proclaimer of Christ, and he was a troublemaker from the mindset of the Jews. So they had conspired to take Paul's life. But Paul says, I was lowered in a basket from a window in the wall and slipped through their hands. And the story is told by Luke in the middle of Acts chapter 9. Facing persecution, fearing for his life, Paul runs for his life. In verse 26 of this chapter, Paul is constantly on the move. And this is where he got his running shoes. This is where it all started. He is lowered in this basket that would hold dry fish out of a window. No angels, no blinding of his enemies, no overpowering of the guards coming to arrest him. But something so minor, so minuscule, so easy to overlook, that this actually magnifies the God of power and the God of grace. A simple story of escaping danger that underscores his desperate need for God and his desperate need for others. It may not be the most spectacular account. It may not bring a standing ovation of praise. But there is probably a story in your life that you might even feel a little bit, it's not that big of an issue. And it seems so minor, so little. But the divine fingerprints are all over the page. It's obvious that God has come through, and that God has delivered, and that God has responded. And those are the kind of stories that God loves for you and me to talk about. Because it's not about us, but it's about what God has done for you and me. Even as we come to terms with how dependent we are on God and how much we truly need others. You know, a couple of days ago, one of our students at Talbot had to do a class assignment to interview five pastors, and so I'm an easy target. And so he interviewed me. I won't mention his name, but... There were questions related to leadership and how I decided to become a pastor and what were some of the highlights of my ministry and what are some of the lowlights of my ministry. And the last question of this now anonymous student was, what is some advice you would give to us as seminarians preparing for ministry? And I thought of the words of Paul. I thought of Paul's words toward the end of his ministry where he wrote Timothy, his protege, a young man that he was pouring his life into, and how he said, Timothy, people will look down on you because you're young, but be someone that people look up to because you're godly. I remember when I first came here back in 1996, I was a younger man. And I was a younger man, and I'll never forget someone, a leader of the church, I will not mention this person's name, but a leader of the church came up to me and said, Dan, I'm so glad that you're here. I just wish you were a little bit older. That's called backhanded praise. You can't change some things. And as I was talking to this student, you know, there is something about being young that people naturally condescend, and especially in a culture like ours that says, well, you need more experience, you need more bags under your eyes, you need more tread worn off of your tires, and then I'll begin listening to you. But Paul said to Timothy, don't be someone that is looked down upon because you're young, but be someone that people look up to because you're godly, that you set an example in speech and life and love and faith and purity, and that you truly watch your life and your teaching closely. And then I thought of Paul's second letter to Timothy, and Paul is about to die. And he says to Timothy, preach the word. There'll be times when people love your preaching, and there'll be times when people throw it back in your face. But do the work of an evangelist. Fight the good fight. Finish the race. Keep the faith. And Paul says, that is what I've done. And I want to live my life today for the long haul. And I thought, you know what? What Paul said to Timothy and what I said to the student is what God speaks to us. We are better people. We are better leaders. We have a better ministry when we are both tough, tenacious, and tender. Compassionate. You see, Paul got what it takes to be a better servant. And we serve Jesus better when we never quit and when we always care. When Jesus, when he gets the final glory and the final praise, it will be because your spirit is tenacious and your heart is tender. So let's cultivate a better life by refusing to walk away from Jesus. And let's create a superior ministry by resolving to stay close to one another. Let's pray together. There's not a person in this room that doesn't want to be better, to be a better servant of God, to be a better child of the King, to be a part of a better ministry. And it feels uncomfortable to say we're better than others. And yet, when we talk about the distinguishing texture of what makes us better than others, ironically, it's not about us, but it's about the fingerprints of God's Spirit and what he does in your life and mine. And it's possible this morning that you are battling to hang on, that you're tempted to walk away where there's more questions than answers. I want to speak to you and to say, hang tough. Hold on to a tenacious spirit. And it's possible that you may see someone battling a weakness, even giving in to sin, and your heart burns with anger, with sadness. And God may want to use you this week to bring them back to Him. Father, thank You for this morning that we've shared together. And our prayer for this week is, even as we approach the Thanksgiving holiday, we do give thanks to You because You've given to us the very best, that the one who is rich became poor so that we might become rich. And we pray that out of grateful and overflowing hearts, that we would bring life and joy to those around us, so that they could give thanks and that they could give to others. And we pray this in Jesus' name.